Now, I know what you're thinking. Garon Seho, this isn't your usual type of video. And you'd be right. While I normally do voice work, like with Pokemon Speak, I do have an affinity for music. I'm not a bad singer, and I used to know how to play the ukulele, though that skill has been lost to time. So when I watched Nandove Movie's video on his newest YouTube collaboration, One Musical Scene, I started thinking about what I could add. Many YouTubers who are far wiser and better at editing than I have already done so much, so what could I, a lowly voice acting YouTuber with a little over 150 subscribers, add to the table? That's what I'm here to discuss today. So, Mr. Nando, hi, my name is Michael, I go by Garon Seho, and this is my One Musical Scene video. Also, I've been planning out how I would write my own DC movie universe, and I plan to put that on YouTube at some point in the future, so if you could, like, let me know what you think of it whenever that comes out, that would be so amazing. But enough begging to be noticed by YouTube senpais. Time for my One Musical Scene. Now, normally, I would put an intro here, but, I don't have one of those. So instead, you get me rambling for a few seconds. Okay, on with the video. Now, I should probably tell you what my scene is. It's in Doctor Strange and the Multiverse of Madness, spoiler alert, but it's also in Ms. Marvel, again, spoilers. I assume you know what I'm talking about, but in case you don't, I'm talking about this scene.
We should tell him the truth.
Our final member, Professor Charles Xavier.
I'm also talking about this scene.
Kamala, there's something different in your genes, like a mutation.
And what do these two scenes have in common? The opening theme from the 90s X-Men cartoon. Even if you've never watched the 90s X-Men show, I bet you've still heard this theme before. It's one of those iconic theme songs that'll remain in pop culture forever, like the 60s Spider-Man theme, or the Batman the Animated Series opening. And it's no mystery why this theme was put into these projects, to grab some of that sweet, sweet nostalgia. Because the MCU has three major themes in Phase 4 as of now: the multiverse, legacy characters, and nostalgia. The most obvious examples of this are in movies like Spider-Man No Way Home and Doctor Strange 2, but it's appearing all over the place. Kingpin showing up at the end of Hawkeye, Daredevil showing up in She-Hulk, Marvel is milking nostalgia for all it's worth. And how much is it worth, you may ask? Give me a second. $1.9 billion if No Way Home's box office returns are to be believed. So, what's my point? Marvel's using nostalgia, big whoop. What I'm trying to emphasize here is that Marvel is using nostalgia correctly. To prove my point, I'll give an example of incorrectly used nostalgia. Now, if only there was another popular franchise owned by Disney that weaponized nostalgia in its newer projects just to get views, but the bait had no substance past trailer fodder and recognizing older characters. Oh, I got it! DuckTales! I'm obviously talking about Star Wars, and the difference is massive. Let's take a look at an example, say, The Book of Boba Fett. Now, on paper, this show is a nostalgia goldmine. It stars a character that has been a fan favorite since the holiday special, who spends his entire time on a giant ball of Star Wars known as Tatooine. Hell, in the sequel trilogy, Jakku is just Tatooine Light. Disney knows that these things will give people nostalgia, but the thing is, nostalgia can't carry a whole production. Also, side note, if Star Wars is so intent on using nostalgia to advertise their projects, you'd think they would use tracks from the original and prequel trilogies, like The Imperial March, Twin Sunsets, and Duel of the Fates. Just an observation. Anyway, back to The Book of Boba Fett. It expects the show to be well received simply because Boba Fett is in it, and they do this trick multiple times, with Cad Bane, Grogu, and deepfake Luke Skywalker. Disney is hoping that people will like the show, regardless of what happens, simply because the audience is doing that Leo DiCaprio meme every episode. No, not that one. That's the one. Now, that's not to say that Star Wars can't use nostalgia correctly ever. I'd say that the Obi-Wan show had a good balance of nostalgia with Little Leia, Darth Vader, and Obi-Wan himself, along with a compelling story. I actually really like the Kenobi show, but since that's a divisive take that is sure to give me death threats, I'll go to something a little more well-liked. The Mandalorian Season 2. We got Ahsoka Tano and Bo-Katan Kryze in live action, Boba Fett, and there were even rumors that Sabine Wren was gonna show up, but she was apparently cut from the show. And of course, we can't forget the first time deepfake Luke Skywalker graced our screens with his Uncanny Valley face. I think most of this nostalgia bait was done well too. It wasn't too forced, at least not to the point where it got annoying, and the season still told a compelling story. Now, let's look at Marvel's use of nostalgia in Spider-Man No Way Home. It tells a compelling story that incorporates the nostalgia bait seamlessly without alienating those who haven't seen the non-MCU Spider-Man movies. Practically perfect. Of course, this is a one musical scene video, so let's tie this back into music. I think that there is one small change that could be made, yes, this is another Nando property, to bring the movie to absolute perfection. And it goes a little something like this.
Wait! I love you guys. Thank you.
Alright, let's do this.
Did you catch it? I'll play the original scene for comparison.
Let's do this.
Ready? Wait!
I love you guys. Thank you.
All right, let's do this.
It's the music. The edited version by Ashish S.K. King, I hope I pronounced that right, incorporates a redone version of the 60s Spider-Man theme, once again injecting nostalgia into the movie without it feeling forced. That is how to correctly utilize nostalgia. So, going back to the scenes in question, Professor X's arrival and Ms. Marvel finding out she's a mutant, the 90s X-Men theme is the perfect way to represent X-Men nostalgia. For Charles' entry, it symbolizes the legacy of Professor X. This guy brought together the X-Men, whom this iconic theme belongs to. For Ms. Marvel, it looks forward to the future of the mutants in the MCU. Ms. Marvel is the first confirmed mutant in Earth 199999. I refuse to call it 616, Iman Vellani would be proud. And this theme plays to remind you of what mutants mean. When used correctly, the right track can make any moment one musical scene.
Roll credits.
So, this is my first video of the talk to the audience variety. How'd I do? I plan to do more of these in the future. Like I said, I'm writing my own DC movie universe, so that'll be fun. So if you like this video, let me know in the comments. And subscribe if you want to hear more of my incessant rambling. And of course, thanks to NandoV Movies for this wonderful opportunity. See ya!